We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nii-Quartelai. Thanks so much for joining us this morning. It's really great to be with you right here, LATalkLive.com, where we're more than just talk. What a week I've had. First of all, on Tuesday, I had an incredible opportunity to have a lunch with an incredible U.S. Senator. Dianne Feinstein invited me and maybe about 15 other younger politicos to lunch. It's a lunch in West Hollywood. We had a terrific lunch. I had a chance to meet folks like Charlie Ebersol of Ebersol fame. You know, folks from some of California's most distinguished tech companies, distinguished producers, you know, distinguished politicos. It was really incredible to be able to sit down with the senator for almost a couple hours and to have a conversation about who everyone was in the room and how they got to where they are. Fantastic. Big thank you to Trevor Daly, the deputy director here in California for Senator Feinstein's office for making that luncheon possible. It was fantastic. Hope to do it again soon. Wow. Dianne Feinstein. Wow. I think she's running for re-election. She's running for re-election here in California. So on November 6th, be sure to vote for U.S. Senator Dianne Feinstein. She's incredible. She's been serving our state for a long time, and she has still yet more to do. Moving along, last night I had a great time with the folks over at Long Beach Lambda Democratic Club. Can we give the Long Beach Lambda Democratic folks a hand clap? I think they deserve a hand clap for yesterday. Yesterday, I had, there we go, hand clap for Long Beach Lambda. They honored me with the Michael Lonergan Award, which is given to a state or national political figure that's bringing people together. And I was really moved by it. I think you see a picture up on the screen right now. That's with me and Kenya T. Parham, who we'll hear a little bit more from later. Kenya was one of the event organizers and had called to inform me that I had been selected to receive the Michael Lonergan Award. And so I am very grateful for that. It's always great to be recognized for bringing people together, because I believe we're all in this together. And so big thank you to Long Beach Lambda Democratic Club Reggie Jones Sawyer, who gave me the award last night, an old friend. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Moving things along, how many of you had a chance to see the debate, the vice presidential debate? I think we have a caller that might have been able to see the vice presidential debate. Yeah. The vice presidential debate was spectacular. It was spectacular. I think Vice President Joe Biden won the debate hands down. But you don't have to take my word for it. Let's show you just sort of a real quick highlight reel of what happened at yesterday's, or not yesterday, last week's debate. It was incredible, I think, to say the least. And here it is.
This is a bunch of stuff. Look, here's the deal.
What does that mean, a bunch of stuff?
Well, it means it's simply inaccurate.
It's Irish.
It is. We Irish call it malarkey.
Thanks for the translation.
No, okay. We Irish call it malarkey. But last thing.
They're moving faster toward a nuclear weapon. They're spinning the centrifuges faster. They see us saying when we come into the administration, when they're sworn in, we need more space with our ally Israel.
I've had it up to here with this notion that 47%, it's about time they take some responsibility here. And instead of signing pledges to Grover Norquist not to ask the wealthiest among us to contribute to bring back the middle class, they should be signing a pledge saying to the middle class, we're going to level the playing field.
7.4 million seniors are projected to lose the current Medicare Advantage coverage they have. That's a $3,200 benefit cut.
That didn't
happen.
What
we're saying,
more people signed up.
These are from your own actuaries.
More people signed up for Medicare Advantage after the change.
What they're saying.
Nobody is.
Mr. Vice President, I know.
No, this is
Mr. Vice President, I know you're under a lot of duress to make up for lost ground. But I think people will be better served if we don't keep interrupting each other. You can cut tax rates by 20%. And still preserve these important preferences for middle class taxpayers.
Not mathematically possible.
It is mathematically possible. It's been done before. It's precisely what we're proposing.
It has never been done before.
It's been done a couple of times, actually.
It has never been done
Jack Kennedy
done
lowered tax rates, increased growth.
Reagan. Now you're Jack Kennedy.
Ronald Reagan. Now, you want to ask basically why I'm pro-life? It's not simply because of my Catholic faith. That's a factor, of course. But it's also because of reason and science.
My friend says that 30% of the American people are takers. Romney points out 47% of the people won't take responsibility. He's talking about my mother and father. He's talking about the places I grew up in, my neighbors in Scranton and Claymont. He's talking about the people that built this country.
Mitt Romney and I want to earn your support. We're offering real reforms for a real recovery for every American.
And there you have it. There you have it. Are 30% of Americans, are 30% of us takers? What do you think? I strongly disagree. Surprise, surprise. But I don't know. Our guest for the morning may feel differently. More on the vice presidential debate. More on the vice presidential debate when we return after this. You're listening to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com. We'll be back in a moment. Back after this.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes a fighter. Put that fever lighter. Doesn't mean I'm over, cause you're gone. What doesn't kill you makes a fighter.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Introducing Miss Margot Hudson and the hottest new love and relationship radio show,
Destination Love Life, where love and wellness come together as one.
Every Monday at 10 a.m.
Join us as we give the latest in love advice,
tips,
interviews,
news,
call-ins,
games,
and giveaways,
exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream. Use your Android phone, iPhone, iPad, whatever you have, prepaid, BlackBerry, let's do it.
Destination Love Life, every Monday, 10 a.m. Reality Radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure.
We are more than just talk.
Help, love, healing, laughter.
The Margot Hudson Way, every Monday, 10 a.m. Ooh, right in your ear hole.
Ooh, Rob, I like your brain.
I've never heard nobody say they want to suck on my intelligence.
Crazy. We'll see you there, everybody.
Hi, this is Susie Pruden. And yes, you've seen me on Oprah, Good Morning America, and The Today Show. And I'm inviting you to join me every Monday from 3 to 4 for my new show, Mastermind Live. Join us as we introduce you to the new thought leaders of the world who will inspire you, support you, and guide you to your next level. So don't forget to tune into Mastermind Live exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey everybody, this is Richard Carr inviting you to join me in the radio boardroom for the new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit in my all new day and time. That's right, the new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit is moving to Mondays at 5 p.m. Pacific. So don't forget the new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit, now Mondays at 5 p.m. Pacific, exclusively here on LA Talk Live, where it's more than just talk. We'll see you there.
Yeah, it's your boy DJ Deezy inviting you to join me every Monday night at 8 p.m. for our new show, Keeping It Real with the Cousins, exclusively on LA Talk Live, Monday nights at 8. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio or watch us on Ustream TV, Monday nights at 8. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Welcome back to People Are Talking, only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nii-Quartelai. Thanks so much for joining us. I have some unfortunate news this morning, breaking news. According to the son of Senator Arlen Specter, he has died. Senator Specter was a longtime Republican representing the state of Pennsylvania. He recently had switched parties. In 2010, had switched parties, had switched from Republican to Democrat, and had lent some support to President Barack Obama, and his health care fight in particular. And Senator Specter has a very long history in Washington, a long history representing the people of Pennsylvania. Our hearts go out to his family. He's been battling cancer for quite a while, several bouts with cancer. This morning, Senator Arlen Specter of Pennsylvania has died. On to other news, the vice presidential debate. Before we went to break, you had a chance to see some of the highlights, just a few of the highlights from the vice presidential debate that was watched by like 50 million people. That's a lot of people. That's more than Idol. Almost twice as many. I'm now joined by Kenya T. Parham, our People Are Talking political contributor this morning. She's also a campaign consultant extraordinaire. Kenya.
Hello.
Thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much for having me.
I feel like I just saw you.
Because we've seen a lot of each other lately. I did just see you less than 12 hours
ago. Less than 12 hours ago. As I mentioned earlier, I was honored by the Lambda Democratic Club, the Long Beach Lambda Democratic Club, last night with the Michael Lonergan Award. And Kenya was the one that called me to say, hey, we want to honor you. And so I really appreciate that. It was very moving.
You're so deserving of it.
Well, thank you.
As Reggie Jones-Sawyer so eloquently put.
Well, thank you. We do what we can, right? So on to the vice presidential debate. Did you think the debate revealed anything about Vice President Biden or Congressman Ryan that voters needed to know?
It revealed. I think it revealed something about Ryan. That he's kind of bought into the rhetoric. The rhetoric spewing of the GOP party right now. I mean, I think it's kind of interesting to see how, in my opinion, how desperate they are for a centralized message and the degree to which they will go to in order to make sure that those talking points hit out there. I mean, you know, you and I both know in the consulting world, you've got key points whenever you're working with a candidate. Mm-hmm. And sometimes those are positive and sometimes those are negative. Depends on what side you're on. Right.
Yes. Yes.
And so I think it's just very poignant to note how visible it is. Mm-hmm. That's a line, talking line.
They are not hiding.
That's a line.
They act like we don't live in the information age.
I mean, really, like you can, I mean, it was almost fun. I mean, you know, I don't know what you were doing during the debate. I was by myself, but I thought to myself.
You weren't doing a drinking game, were you?
I thought to myself, should I have done a drinking game? I would be on the floor right now because it's kind of ridiculous. And I think that they showed, it affirmed the faith in Biden. I think a lot of times, especially in the last couple of years, he has kind of been placated to the left a little bit just because he's a little emotional with his words. Mm-hmm. I understand because I like to speak off the cuff too. Mm-hmm. But I think it affirmed the backup, like the dream team a little bit. I think they were like, oh, okay, should we need Biden to come in?
That's he's why they're a solid
definitely,
team.
Yeah, he's definitely got it. And I think it was very assuring for me as a Democrat to just see how seasoned and experienced he is. I mean, when you talk about being cool with Netanyahu for 37 years, he's like, I've known him for 37 years, little boy.
Yeah.
That's what he's, you know what I mean? I mean, it was like child abuse.
Didn't it make him look so small?
It made
Paul Ryan look so small, that moment where, you know, he was talking about Bibi Netanyahu of Israel, was talking about him in a way that Joe Biden was able to just sort of obliterate. He's like, I've known this man for a long time. Essentially, he's on speed dial. We are cool. We know exactly where each other's coming from.
And Joe had a difficult time, too. I think he wanted to put him in his place so badly that he had to check himself, like, that's classified. That note, what I want to say right there is classified, too. But let me tell you something. If I didn't have, I would... It was so, I was paying attention on Twitter. I wasn't tweeting while I was doing it, but I was watching Twitter, and Bill Maher had this hilarious tweet where he said, excuse me, 911, there's a senior citizen beating an old man on my floor right now. I just thought that was hilarious. It was just very visible. It was very visible in who was trained for the debate and who just kind of knew the stuff.
Yeah.
And I have to say, I have to give credit to the moderator. Mm-hmm. I just think we should have women moderating debates with with old men.
Martha Raddatz of ABC. She
did
incredible. A terrific job.
She's incredible. And I'm excited that Candy Crowley is going to be doing the next one.
Yeah. Yeah. I think Martha did a much better job than Jim Lehrer. So there was a poll that came out right after the debate. It was a CNN poll. It was a controversial poll. It had given the win to Congressman Ryan. Mm-hmm. Now, for those of us that watched, and then might have watched again. It was clear to us that Ryan did not win that debate, but then there was a CBS poll that came out, mm-hmm. and according to the poll, 50% of uncommitted voters who tuned in Thursday night said that they see Vice President Joe Biden as the winner over Mitt Romney's running mate Paul Ryan, according to an instant poll taken by CBS News. Now, of the 431 people that were polled immediately following the debate, 31% deemed Ryan the winner, and 19% said that they didn't. So they felt it was a tie. Party-wise, it's a switch from last week's presidential debate, which uncommitted voters handed the win over to Romney over President Obama. Now, what does this mean for President Obama's reelection bid? What do you make of this?
Well, I think. Okay, two things. I think that OFA, or, you know, Obama's strategy team, mm-hmm. had been depending a little bit, I think, too much on the media. Mm-hmm. In my mind, in the first debate, they had him be completely presidential and trust that the surrogates and the media would handle taking care of all of the
47%.
Exactly, the 47 and mm-hmm. all of the, you know, extra stuff. And they were like, we're just going to have him be a president. Mm-hmm. And I think that severely hurt him. Mm-hmm. So I think when Joe comes in and has to literally pick up every single, I mean, I feel like Joe Biden went almost as tough as Clinton did in as far as the recovery, the need for support at the time, mm-hmm. you know, as Clinton's speech. And so I think for one, they need to not expect to have the media mm-hmm. in their back pockets. Mm-hmm. Because the media is going to sway depending on what is hot, what people like to
see. They're trying to sell advertising time.
Exactly. And Romney, quite frankly, has bought up quite a lot of time on CNN. I don't know if you've seen these commercials that he has, mm-hmm. but he's there. There's a lot of CNN has seemed to switch a little bit. And, mm-hmm. and I noticed that the difference in the post debate commentary was mm-hmm. much different than I expected to see on CNN, mm-hmm. Than on MSNBC or CBS or ABC even. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's one thing. I think that that Obama strategy team had been depending a little bit too much on the media favoring them. And, you know, just being ridiculous and being a liar, as we know, in politics isn't enough to get people to vote for you, the other person.
Well, you know, I would say, you know, I don't think that the campaign is necessarily I don't think their expectation is necessarily that the media will, you know, cater to them. But I think their expectation is that the media will weigh fact much greater than opinion. And,
okay.
And I think, you know, what is at stake in this election is facts triumphing over opinion and just, you know, lies, quite frankly. And if we allow the other side to win this election, then it sets an incredible precedent in our country in terms of how we not just run political campaigns for the presidency, but, you know, what people are able to get away with. And I think Romney's been able to get away with a whole lot. I mean, I am shocked.
He's not the first one, though. I mean, I think that precedent has already kind of been set, and it's kind of been a tug of war mm-hmm. over the last 10, 20 years to hopefully put fact on a much higher pedestal than opinion. But fact is fluid. Fact is fluid right now. This is at least how I look at it. You know, I don't think there are... there's enough of an incentive for folks
to tell the truth.
To tell the truth. And the truth, I mean, reality is perception. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's so many, the vocabularies are rampant. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's too many words to describe things. There's too many ways to spin things. Stuff is so multifaceted. You can tell one side of it and still tell the truth and be telling a lie by not telling the other side mm-hmm. of it. Mm-hmm. You know, I just think that fact is too fluid right now across the board. Mm-hmm. And I think that the things that have happened in our past, especially in the last 10 years of our political history, have made it a lot more easy for folks like Romney and Ryan to come up and literally say anything.
Now, also, according to the CBS poll, both Biden and Ryan, they gain ground on relatability and knowledge. Mm-hmm. The percentage of voters who say they believe they can relate to Biden, it spiked. It spiked from 34% before the debate to 55% after. 48% think Ryan is relatable, up from 31% before the debate. Meanwhile, after watching the two candidates, you have 85%. 85% of those polled think that Biden is knowledgeable about the issue, 75% for Ryan. How important, as a political consultant, as a political strategist, can you tell us a little bit about why it's important, how it's important, relatability in this election, and should this be a factor in choosing a president? There's some people that say, you know what, I don't want my president to be relatable. I want them to be smart. I want them to be effective. I want them to be hardworking.
Well, it's extremely important is the first bottom line. I think the relatability thing comes from, you know, very simply put, we see and like to relate to things that we project that are familiar to us. Most familiar thing to ourselves is what we is our self-perception. So if I, you know, if I hold myself in any kind of regard, you know, and think that I am at least intelligent, when I relate to people, next time I see an intelligent person or somebody that I identify as intelligent, I'm gonna be like, oh, I like that person. I see something in them, even if it's a subconscious thing. And so the key to relatability is trying to be direct enough that you do not blend in and you have a specific specific platform and uniqueness about you, but to be broad enough that there are enough people that can identify key traits about you from their level of comfortability, from what they identify with.
Now, does Biden's winning performance, does it raise the stakes for Obama in the upcoming presidential debate?
You know, I can remember moments 4 years ago when I was looking at the screen like, what is he doing? And then 2 weeks later, I was like, oh,
yeah,
that's what he was doing. You know, so I don't think anybody is confused into thinking that President Obama does not know how to debate. I mean, this man is an incredible debater. Mm-hmm. He's an incredible debater. And I'm not really up to speed on what the strategy was for the first debate. But, you know, knowing that we've got a town hall setting coming up and then a foreign policy debate coming up next, I mean,
That's his element.
That's exactly. He's in, you know, so not to say that if there was one to not do well on, I would rather it be the one that just passed, but I just said it.
Well, we have more to talk about when we come back. We are here with Kenya T. Parham. Our People Are Talking political contributor. She is a political consultant here in Los Angeles. She's extraordinary. Coming up, we're just 3 weeks away from the November election, and there couldn't be more at stake for our city, for our state, for our country. I want to hear your questions. We want to talk a little bit more about the Obama Romney tug of war, we have to get a sense of what they have to do, what they have to do in this upcoming presidential debate on Tuesday. You're listening to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com. We'll be back in a moment, back after this.
Down on my knee, I wanna take. Are you getting out to vote on Tuesday, November 6th? I know I am. Hi, this is Julie Orlov of Pathways to Love, and I'm joining LA Talk Live in encouraging the citizens of Los Angeles to get out and vote on Election Day. As you know, this is one of the most important elections in our American history, and we need everyone in LA to register and have a voice on November 6th. Currently, the state of California has 6.5 million people eligible but not yet registered to vote, and about half of those voters live in LA County. So I'm joining the family here at LA Talk Live in encouraging you to register and vote on Tuesday, November 6th. And if you haven't yet registered, don't worry, you have until midnight, October 22nd, and you can now even register online. That's right, if you have a signature file online with the DMV or a state ID number, you can now register to vote at registertovote.ca.gov. And don't forget to join us here on Tuesday, November 6th for LA Get Out and Vote, our live Election Day coverage from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., where we are going to keep you tuned in exclusively to LA election news and poll coverage all day right here on LA Talk Live, where we are more than just talk.
Hey, are you spending your time or are you wasting your time? Well, kill some time hanging out with Michael Kaya, Brooks Jackson, and the whole crew at the Michael Kaya Morning Show. I get up late. That's every Tuesday, 3 until 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you don't know what that is, you better get on the internet and look it up. And while you're there, go to latalklive.com and check me out.
Hi, this is Demetrius.
And I'm AJ, inviting you to join us every Tuesday at 5:30 for our all-new show, Real Talk with Demetrius and AJ.
We are your alternative to mainstream media's non-discussion of the real issues. No more sound bites, no more talking points, just real talk.
The guests on our show will include a wide array of people from all walks of life, elected officials, politically active celebrities, young leaders, and most importantly, you will all be included in this dialogue that is sure to be provocative and real.
So don't forget to tune in and listen to Real Talk with Demetrius and AJ every Tuesday at 5:30, exclusively on latalklive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio.
Or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure.
This is LA Talk Live.
And we are more than just talk.
Hi, it's your girl Miles Bloxon.
Your boy Zoe Johnson.
Asia Kim.
And this is Dallas Stokes.
And we're inviting you to join us every Tuesday from 7 to 9 for our new show, Ladies and Gentlemen, The Battle of the Sexes.
And we battle, y'all, trust me.
All the time.
Yes, sir.
Join us as we discuss relationships, fashion, sports, entertainment, and comedy from a male and female point of view.
But listen to the male's point of view, please.
Oh, geez.
What's wrong with your voice?
I don't know. I'm just trying to be sexy.
Okay.
So don't forget to tune in to Ladies and Gentlemen every Tuesday night from 7 to 9, exclusively on latalklive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure.
This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk.
Yes, so Miles, do not talk ever again, okay?
Okay, Zoe, only if you start
listening.
It's a talk
show,
Zoe. I'm just saying.
Oh, my gosh, Zoe.
Like, look, I'm tired of hearing her male.
Asia, please.
We're tired of hearing your raspy R&B voice as well.
Oh, my gosh.
Just a city boy, born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going anywhere.
Welcome back, welcome back. I'm Nii-Quartelai Qyartey, and you're watching and listening to People Are Talking only on latalklive.com. I'm joined with the lovely and talented Kenya T. Parham.
Hello, hello.
People Are Talking political contributor and political consultant extraordinaire. You better get her while you can.
While it's cheap.
While it's cheaper. There we go. So we've been talking about the vice presidential debate this morning, talking a little bit about what President Obama and Mitt Romney, quite frankly, what they have to do in this next debate. One point that you just raised during the break, Kenya, you were talking about the question about Vice President Biden and Congressman Ryan's Catholicism, and how that question about their faith often comes up. Anybody's faith, it comes up in the context of abortion. What did you think about that?
Well, you know, I think in Catholicism, it's a little easier to pinpoint because, you know, the biggest critique with that is that, you know, they don't believe in contraception. So naturally, if you talk about contraception, that's going to lead to, you know, reproductive rights and abortion conversation. But on a larger scale, when discussing religious beliefs and Mitt Romney too, because I don't really know. I know he's Mormon, but it seems like he's maybe converted to Christianity over the last couple of weeks. I'm not really sure.
Not only is he Mormon, but Mitt Romney, I think, is also, he's a bishop in the Mormon church.
He is appointed.
I think it's so amazing that he has been able to go through this whole campaign over the past couple years. And has not had to talk about his faith, a faith that is unclear to a whole lot of Americans. I certainly don't begrudge anybody of any faith, but this is something that at least the other side has been hitting President Obama over the head with since he ran for office. And so it's interesting that President Obama's faith is on the table, but Republicans have been successful at taking Mitt Romney's Mormon faith off the table.
Very much so, because they have to. I mean, you know, let's go back to what we were saying before. Mm-hmm. So in the context of speaking about religious beliefs and, you know, of course, the only thing acceptable right now with status quo is being a Christian or God, believing in God, Jesus, possibly, if you're Mitt Romney, you know, a candidate, is that, you know, when you discuss abortion, that's the only thing linked to your faith. I have a problem with that because if you're a Christian, you're a Christian 24 hours a day. You encounter so many different things, especially if you're in an elected office, that would you would be able to draw on and speak about, you know, in relation to your faith, like gun control. Like the death penalty, you know, and several other things that I feel like are never brought up in the context of religion. It's always a policy issue. And they seem to separate, like the only thing that gets connected to religion is the reproductive conversation, which, you know, I don't think men should be discussing anyway.
That's interesting. I think there's even a point in the debate where both of the candidates agreed that their faith is very much a part of, you know, how they make decisions in public office.
They both said that. She asked them that specific question. She said, how much does your Catholicism influence your decision making? I think was the question. And you know, they both answered. That was a setup. You know what I mean? Like debate strategy 101. That was a setup. They both of their answers. It was an open-ended question.
Yeah.
Both of them decided to talk about abortion.
Now, here in California, it's important to note that vote by mail ballots went out on October 8th. And for listeners in other parts of the country, early voting has started in some places and in other areas like Nevada. I think they start on October 20th. You can go to gottavote.org. That's G-O-T-T-A, vote.org. Excuse our grammar, all English teachers out there. gottavote.org to find out everything that you need, not only to get registered to vote, but what you need to bring to the polls so there's no funny business. Because there's been a lot of funny business across the country. And we can't let that happen because there's so much at stake. Kenya, you mentioned the death penalty. I will mention three strikes. These are two issues that, at least here in California, the people will be voting on this November. Can you tell us a little bit about what local races and statewide initiatives you're going to be tracking on election night?
Oh, my goodness. There's so many props up right now for the state of California that are very, very concerning. I'm very concerned. Mm-hmm. Three strikes. Mm-hmm. 38. Mm-hmm. What else?
That's the Molly Munger.
The Molly Munger
education initiative.
Yeah, let me not speak in acronyms. Yeah. Uh-huh. That's horrible. I'm really bad at that. What else? Oh my goodness, so many.
32. Yeah.
32, big time.
That's the paycheck protection initiative where you have the Koch brothers and Karl Rove that are pumping millions of dollars into California in order to disrupt the paycheck political contributions that folks are able to make. That is a huge revenue source for our labor unions here in California. If you break our unions, as Scott Walker tried to do in Wisconsin, and as Republicans are doing across the country, then clearly the Republicans will get a huge money advantage in running their candidates and getting their issues passed.
And that's not the only deceptively written proposition either. I think it's 37. The food regulations, is that 37?
Yeah, genetically modified.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. Have you read that?
Not only have I read it, but we've had Annette Aguilar from the Yes on 37 campaign here on the show to talk about it.
It's very interesting the way that that's written too, and what is exempt, what has to be declared, and what hasn't been declared. Uh-huh. So I think that's another one to watch too.
Yeah, yeah, and then certainly, you know, with the tax initiatives, the Governor Brown's tax initiative, that's Yes on 30, versus Molly Munger's tax initiative, Yes on 38. Mm-hmm. In a lot of circles, these are seen as competing initiatives, and it's interesting because right now both of them are polling under 50%, which is bad news. And
not
so
good.
Expect Governor Brown to get out there. I think on Tuesday he's going to fire up the campaign for Yes on 30 right here in Los Angeles. What happens if these don't pass?
You know, 38, I'm very concerned about 38 not passing. 38 has to pass, though, for me, more so than 30, because 38 has like a protection clause in it, where they can't remove it. They can't take anything away from it. 30, if 30 doesn't pass, I mean, I guess we go back to the merry-go-round like before. There's just so much at stake.
Yeah.
It's almost overwhelming for me as a voter, and I consider myself an informed voter, so I can't imagine, you know, what it's like. And I think that's what they count on. You know, the majority, a lot of folks in California don't really pay attention to propositions like they should. They don't feel as an incentive enough to pay attention, even though it's there, the incentive is all there, you know, to be well informed and a voter, and these things are going to affect you and your children and, you know, the area that you live in, etc. But for some reason, there has been a divide and a disconnect with California voters.
Yeah.
You know,
There certainly has.
Props aren't sexy enough, I guess.
Got to get to the ballot box. Well, now in other news, it's time for our pop culture news roundup. Here it is. So the space shuttle Endeavor is making its way to its final resting place.
I'm so confused because they've been making this trip. First of all, three of my days this week were inconvenienced because of this. So I just want to know, when is it going to stop moving?
It's supposed to stop this morning. It's supposed to stop this morning over at the Science Center.
Well, maybe I'll be able to get where I need to go now.
Do we have the photo up? The photo up of the Space Shuttle Endeavor. The Space Shuttle Endeavor. This is a really cool photo. The space shuttle has been making its way up Manchester, I think at like 1 mile an hour. I mean, everything has been timed.
2 miles an hour.
2 miles an hour. There we go. Wow, speed racer.
They just want to make sure that you're going to not miss it.
Exactly, exactly. And don't there's blink. This really cool photo. Is the photo up? This really cool photo of Space Shuttle Endeavor outside of Randy Donuts. Anybody that's ever been to LA, this is like a landmark. The big donut. The big donut. On Manchester.
Have you ever eaten there?
You know, I've never eaten there. Maybe
Me either.
Maybe we should after the show. That's a plug for Randy Donuts. Randy, where's our check?
Pay us. Thank you.
In other news, Representative Sherman and Representative Berman had a little
video?
Bit of a kerfuffle.
Great
at a debate. Representative Sherman said an unflattering video capturing the heated exchange with him and Representative Howard Berman in a debate on Thursday night may cost him a small number of voters, but that longtime supporters will shrug off the incident. He's saying it may cost them something like 300 voters, which in a very close race
is a lot.
Could be more than just a little shrug.
The Berman Sherman race is always a fun one.
Yeah.
To watch. Did you see the video though?
I saw the video. Was it a hug?
It looked like a headlock.
I thought it was a forceful hug.
It looked like a there was a lot of emphasis in this region.
Yeah.
On here. It was just a little.
It looked awkward.
It was very. Because the person. Okay, let me get this right. It was Berman who did the hug, right?
Sherman
who did the hug. Yeah. And Berman looked extremely uncomfortable.
Yes.
Extremely uncomfortable.
It looked like two accountants that were going at it. I was gently uncomfortable just watching it. Moving along, we are so happy to report that Robin Roberts of Yay! Good Morning America is finally back at home. Robin Roberts had received a bone marrow transplant. And after 21 days in the hospital, she is finally back at home. And so we are so proud of it. This is a picture that you see on your screen of Robin leaving the hospital. You may notice that she still has the surgical mask on and gloves as her immune system is beginning to build up. But we wish her nothing but the best. She tweeted, quote, "There's no place like home. After 30 days in the hospital, I'm home. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Thank you and bless you, XO."
And you know what she did when she got home? First thing she did? After taking it in, I saw this video of her standing at the Hudson, looking outside of her window. Uh-huh. She has the Hudson River right there. She had a piece of apple pie and ice cream. And I thought that was so cool.
Wow. We love Robin Roberts.
I love her.
And we wish you the best. You are such an inspiration to so many of us. Well, thank you. Coming up, if there's anything that you want to add to our pop culture roundup, send us a tweet. What's your Twitter handle?
Oh my God. I'm afraid to give it out because I've been so busy working with these campaigns that I have not tweeted since my birthday in June. But if you'd like to follow me, just for kicks, maybe if you talk to me, I'll talk back. Maybe that's what I'm missing. At K Parham, K P as in Peter, A R H A M as in Mary.
You heard it here. You heard it here. As we go to break, you're listening to our marathon song of the week dedicated to all the survivors that are out there making a difference, the Robin Roberts of the world. There are folks that are marching, that are walking in AIDS Walk Los Angeles this morning.
And Chalk Walk.
And chalk walk. There we go. Our hat is tipped off to you. Being a survivor and doing the good people's work is something we do 25/8. Here's Mary J. Blige as we go to break. Back in a moment with our local changemaker report. After this, you're listening to People Are Talking.
I can love you 20. Hey, LA, are you getting out to vote on Tuesday, November 6th? I know I am. This is Lady J of Lady J's Wild World Sports, and I'm joining my family right here, LA Talk Live, encouraging the citizens of Los Angeles to get out and vote on Election Day. As you know, this is one of the most important elections in our American history, and we need everyone in LA to register and have a voice on November 6th. Currently, the state of California, the state we live in, has 6.5 million people eligible but not registered to vote. And about half of those voters live in LA County. So I'm joining the family here at LA Talk Live and encouraging you to register and vote on Tuesday, November 6th. And if you haven't yet registered, don't worry. You have until midnight on October 22nd, and you can now even register online. So there is no excuse. That's right. If you have a signature filed online with DMV or a state ID number, you can now register to vote at registertovote.ca.gov. And don't forget to join us here on Tuesday, November 6th for LA Get Out and Vote, our live Election Day coverage from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., where we're going to keep you tuned in exclusively to LA election news and poll coverage all day right here on my station, LA Talk Live, where we are more than just talk. Okay?
I will retire with the crown. Yes, no, I'm not lucky, I'm blessed. Yes, clap for the heavyweight champ, me. But I couldn't do it all alone. We, Young Money raised me, grew up out in Paisley, Southside Jamaica, Queens, and it's crazy. Cause I'm still hood, Hollywood couldn't change me. Shout out to my haters, sorry that you couldn't faze me.
Welcome back, welcome back to People Are Talking, only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nii-Quartelai Qyartey. You're listening to Nicki Minaj. Moment for Life. It's a pretty good song, yeah? You like that?
It gets you. Everybody at the table was, head was bobbing.
We sure were. We weren't so crazy about how Nicki treated Mariah at American Idol audition, North Carolina. But we'll let that go. That was last week's pop culture roundup.
Yeah, we'll put that to the side.
Well, it's time for our weekly Changemaker Report. This week's local Changemaker is Stephen David Simon, who is joining us by phone. Stephen, are you there?
Yes, here from A-Talk Los Angeles.
Good morning. Stephen is the Stonewall Democratic Club president. He's also a longtime HIV/AIDS activist. In fact, the former L.A. City AIDS coordinator here in Los Angeles. As I mentioned today, he's joining us by phone from AIDS Walk Los Angeles 2012. Good morning, Stephen. How many AIDS walks have you been to? And tell us, how is today different?
Well, I've probably 12 AIDS walks over the last several years. Today is people actually talking about a cure, talking about the end of AIDS at some point. It's something we haven't really talked seriously about for the last several years. There are some 30,000 walkers out here representing all facets of Los Angeles, every race, every age, every gender. It's just really incredible to see people still talking about the HIV epidemic.
Now, you mentioned
30... And they can hear, they're screaming behind me.
We can hear them. So 30,000 folks turning out for AIDS Walk LA this morning. Would you have ever expected AIDS Walk to grow into as big of an event as you see today?
Honestly, we hoped by now that we wouldn't have to be doing AIDS Walks anymore. It continues to grow. We've sort of plateaued the way the epidemic has. There are probably some 50,000 new infections across the country, which has been fairly consistent the last several years. AIDS Walk has had close to 30,000 people the last few years. They're hoping to earn perhaps $2.5 to $3 million for the fight against AIDS here in Los Angeles, which is good, but probably will be down from last year. So we're still struggling to make sure HIV and AIDS stays in the forefront of our political and social and cultural discussions. One thing I'd love to point out, Qyartey, is that there are some 100-plus organizations in the community besides AIDS Project Los Angeles to benefit from AIDS Walk. So the money is spread across Los Angeles City and County to a lot of different communities and organizations.
I did know that. Can you say that again for our listeners who might have missed that?
Yeah, that AIDS Project Los Angeles and AIDS Walk Los Angeles actually distribute the funds throughout Los Angeles City and County, and there are more than 100 organizations who are participating in that actually get funding raised during AIDS Walk.
That's terrific.
That's awesome.
That is really great. So, Stephen, on a personal note, are there any particular friends or loved ones that you'll be thinking about today as you continue to walk and certainly as the festivities wind down?
You know, I'll tell you, I've been doing HIV and AIDS work for about 15 years, and there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of individuals I've met and seen struggle with HIV and AIDS. So I will tell you, one of my earliest moments really dealing with HIV was my own cousin, my first cousin Bobby, who grew up in Antigua in the West Indies, where my family is from. And he passed away being very, very sick and nobody talking about what was wrong with him. Nobody would talk about it. He had to fly to Puerto Rico for medical care. And it took us until after he passed to realize he passed from HIV. And the silence in my own family that went on around that has helped drive me in fighting this epidemic.
Now, how did you get into HIV activism? I think if I remember the story well, you kind of fell into it as a result of an internship in law school. Is that correct?
Well, as you know, I'm an attorney by trade. I was at UCLA Law School. Go Bruins, thank you.
And let that slide.
In my wills and trust class, an attorney from the AIDS Project Los Angeles came in one day and said clients were dying so fast from HIV and AIDS that they couldn't get their health care powers of attorneys done. They couldn't get their wills done. What did that mean? It meant their same-gender partners, if they had them, couldn't visit them in the hospital. It meant when they passed that their homes they'd been living in with their partners would often be taken from that partner. So they asked for help. And I went and volunteered as a law clerk in my second year of law school, and I basically never left. I was hired by AIDS Project Los Angeles when I passed the bar. We founded a nine-attorney law firm, the HIV and AIDS Legal Services Alliance, after that. And then from there, I went into public policy and I basically never looked back. The city hired me to be their AIDS coordinator for 8 years.
Stephen, how can our listeners and viewers continue to support the activist work that you're doing? We know that you're no longer the HIV AIDS coordinator for the city of Los Angeles, but you're still very involved in HIV AIDS activism. What can our listeners and viewers do to support the work that you continue to support?
You know, there are a lot of ways to support and take part in the fight against HIV and AIDS. You know, what we always hear is people asking for money, which is nice that folks have money to give to the fight. That's always wonderful. But I'll tell you, just talking about HIV and AIDS, talking about it at your dinner table, talking about it at your church, talking about it at your work, when you hear people say inappropriate, if not really hateful and hurtful things about people living with HIV, we need to take a stand. We need to speak up. It's a kind of stigma, particularly in our communities, in communities of color, black and brown communities, where we shame people about sex and sexuality in ways that are really horrific, in ways that really help drive this epidemic. So what can your listeners do? It's speak up. Not support that kind of bigotry, not support that kind of hatred. Make the world comfortable for people to be honest and expressive about their sex and sexuality, or if you're using drugs and need help. People need access to and support systems so they can get into drug treatment so they're not spreading HIV through injection drug use. People need to know where they can get free condoms, know where they can get prevention information, and not be afraid to go access it because they want to be seen going into an organization that deals with HIV and AIDS.
Well,
we have the power to end the stigma, and ending the stigma will help end this epidemic.
Well, thank you, Stephen. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for being an incredible local change maker. We appreciate you, and we appreciate all the work that you do, my friend.
Thank you for all the work you do, Qyartey.
Thank you. That's all we're talking about today. I want to thank my guest, Kenya T. Parham, our People Are Talking political contributor and political consultant extraordinaire. You were just listening to Steve Simon, our local changemaker. I want to thank you all for joining us. Until we meet again, do what you can from where you are with what you have. Don't just talk about it. Do it. Good night. Good morning. Good morning. I'm not